The Plot Thickens. 8 Ways to Bring Fiction to Life. Written by Noah Lukeman and narrated by Angus Freethy. Acknowledgements. At the risk of repeating myself, I dedicate this, my second book, once again to my mother. I planned never to write another book on writing and set down some preliminary thoughts on plot for her sake alone. Her encouragement brought forth a chapter. Before I knew it, it was too late to turn back. As always, my family has been there for me, and I am deeply grateful for their support. Introduction. People are always asking me if the university stifles writers. I reply that it hasn't stifled enough of them. There's many a bestseller that could have been prevented by a good writing teacher. Flannery O'Connor. The word plot can cause a great deal of trepidation in writers. This is chiefly because plot has become synonymous with having a great idea, and the pressure to come up with such an idea can be stultifying. The very thought can breed a feeling of futility, since great ideas come and go with the whims of inspiration. It's the purpose of this book to show that plot is not just about having a single great idea. On the contrary, a good plot is an amalgamation of many ideas or elements of writing, including characterization, journey, suspense, conflict, and context. An idea is paramount, but without these supporting elements, an idea by itself is just that, an idea, an abstraction, not a 120 or 300-page living being replete with shades, color, and texture. Most stories do not come in one flash. On the contrary, the best stories are organic with their characters, with their layers of suspense and conflict. Contrary to what many popular books would like you to believe, there is no formula to assure a great or classic plot. There are no steps, paths, no things you must do, and no things you cannot do. This is not a book of rules and mandates. I would be very wary of any such book. On the contrary, this book grapples, philosophically and practically, with age-old principles of story. If you glance at the table of contents, you will not find catchy, gimmicky topics. On the contrary, it deliberately covers familiar ground. Characterization, suspense, conflict. These principles have sustained works for thousands of years and can be found at the core of all great writing. This book differs in that it attempts to cover new ground within these topics, offer examples you will not have seen, and offer exercises you will not have previously considered. Another purpose of this book is to inspire you with new ideas, whether you are revising your work or are embarking on a new project. This is why this book applies equally to the beginning and advanced writer. It is no easier for the advanced writer to come up with ideas, and because I cover such broad principles, this book can apply equally to the novelist, screenwriter, playwright, non-fiction writer, and even poet. After all, the non-fiction writer should be concerned with suspense, as the screenwriter should be concerned with context, as the poet should be concerned with conflict. Two caveats. As I give examples, you'll find abundant references to films, more so than books. I do this because my chief concern is illustrating, sometimes abstract, points, and by referencing films, there is a greater chance that more readers will recognize the reference. I also reference films because film is a medium which has devoted itself to plot, and I would be remiss to ignore them. I also want to show writers they can learn from everything, from Moby Dick to MASH. Caveat 2. Chapters 1 and 2 are exceptions in this book. Chapters 1 and 2 are essentially fleshed-out questionnaires designed to help the writer explore his character. As such, they are comprised of roughly 90% questions and 10% discussion. This is not a safe book. It's impossible for you to read it and not walk away armed with a host of new ideas. It will push you to your limits as it forces you to explore every last aspect of your work. God knows I have been pushed to mine, since, as a literary agent, I have read over 50,000 manuscripts in the last 5 years. Now I will teach back to you what you taught me. Now I will return the favor. Chapter 1. Characterization, the Outer Life. Begin with an individual, and you find you have created a type. Begin with a type, and you find that you have created nothing. F. Scott Fitzgerald. You may have been in a situation, perhaps in a government office, where you've been asked for your mother's social security number, your father's place of birth, and realized in a horrific flash that you don't really know the people you think you know best in the world. This is all the more true of the people you attempt to create out of sheer imagination, often on a whim, people whose very existence can be the result of mere circumstance or plot twist. You have no opportunity to spend time with them as living, breathing people, to eat lunch with them, get drunk with them, play sports with them, watch them at work. You can only add imagination to imagination, picture how they might act in imagined circumstances and settings. In real life, though, when we anticipate scenarios, we are often wrong. Ultimately, human beings are impossible to predict, and there are factors we just can't anticipate. To even begin to try to accurately bring a character to life on the page, you must do your homework, quiz yourself fastidiously about every last detail of the character's inner and outer life. The seemingly insurmountable task of capturing this person on the page will become possible, even easy, once the details are laid out before you. It is the details that will guide you, show you what to do. Once you really know your character, your knowledge will flow unmistakably through the text, like an undercurrent. It will authenticate every word, gesture, and action. Without this knowledge, you're lost. As a writer, you have no visuals or audio to assist you, only words on paper, or, as Toni Morrison says, only the 26 letters of the alphabet. As character is the basis for all further talk of journey, conflict, suspense, and is the cornerstone of plot, we begin this book with the construction of character, which we cover in three chapters. This chapter, the first, is designed to quiz you on the extent of your knowledge of your character's surface or outer life. It will prompt you to consider facets you may not have previously considered. Write down your discoveries as you go. And as narrator of this audiobook, I would emphasize the point that taking notes as you go along might be extremely useful. I use he predominantly and she in instances where the facet is particular to a woman. Keep in mind, though, that all facets should be considered for both sexes. There is a disclaimer in the digital or printed version of this book which mentions that the use of he is solely a grammatical convenience. So, first, appearance. The biggest mistake writers make is feeling compelled to set down their character's physical appearance immediately, usually at the expense of the narrative. You can get to know someone without knowing what they look like. By phone, by mail, online, through a confessional. Looks fade and even change, and people are not the sum of their physical parts. It is important for you to know, for yourself, every aspect of your character's appearance. Just not crucial to divulge it all to the reader, and certainly not right away, unless the story demands it. Ideally, you will leak the description at opportune times, preferably earlier, in unique ways and in palatable doses. Imagine the following four scenarios in helping you accurately portray your character. Police sketch. A murderer is on the loose. He has been terrorizing the city for months, but there is not a single living witness to give a description of him. He strikes again, and this time you watch him in the act. Get a good look at him before he flees. The entire city is looking to you for an answer. Across from you sits a professional police artist. Behind you hover 10 detectives waiting. What does this man look like? Appearance 1. Face. What is his facial structure? Does he have elongated cheekbones, wide, sturdy jaws, broad forehead, a jutting chin, or no chin at all? Or perhaps he's overweight and has 3 chins? Does he have wide, thick, brutal lips? Or small, thin lips pinched tightly together? A huge nose, a small one, broad or narrow, short or long, eyes large or small, close together or far apart. What color are they? Is he cross-eyed? A glass eye? Does one eye wander? What about his eyebrows, his eyelashes? Does he have any facial hair? A moustache? Beard? Goatee? Long sideburns? Is he tan or pale? What is his race? Does he have any deformities? Any scars, moles, burns, injuries? Overall, would you consider this person good-looking? Hair. Does he have any? What color is it? Is it long, short, curly, straight, wavy, thinning, balding, dyed, healthy or unkempt, tied back in a ponytail, hanging over his eyes, curled in dreadlocks? Body. How tall is he? How much does he weigh? Is he fat, skinny, muscular? Are some body parts in better shape than others? Does he have muscular arms but a big belly, broad shoulders but skinny legs? Age. How old is he? Is it easy or hard to tell? What physical signs of age are there? Wrinkles? Crow's feet? Jowls? Spots? Does he look prematurely old at 20? Or like a teenager at 42? If you had to say he looked like one person, who would it be? Let's say the murderer is a woman. Some other questions might arise. Does she have large or small breasts? Her waist? Hips? Legs? How does she keep her nails? Bitten to the bone? Perfectly manicured? Painted black? Fake extensions? Does she have long eyelashes? Does she use mascara? Makeup? Does she wear too much? Not enough? Is she naturally beautiful? If you had to say she looked like one person, who would it be? Now, leaving the police room, apply these rigorous questions to the characters in your work. What details might you add that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character his analysis of himself, would there be any discrepancy? Denial. Does he think he's handsome, even though objectively he's not? Or does he think he's ugly, although he's good-looking? Does he consider himself young, although he's obviously well-aged? Does he think he's short, although he's over 6 feet? Does she think she's heavy, even though there's not an ounce of fat on her? What do any of these discrepancies say about the character? Do they point to a greater issue? A crowded room. Imagine you've set up a friend on a blind date. You've described to your friend what his date looks like, but now he's standing in the bar where they're supposed to meet, and there are over 200 people and potentially many girls who fit her description. He calls you from a payphone and needs to know more. He's already been there for 20 minutes, and he fears if he doesn't find her soon, they'll miss each other. What can you tell him? Appearance, too. Clothes. What does she normally wear? Designer clothes? Work clothes? Casual? Salvation Army? Are her clothes generally revealing? Does she wear mini skirts and a low-cut blouse? Or does she tend to cover every inch, wearing skirts down to her ankles and modest oversized sweaters? Does she wear large straw hats, tie her hair back with bandanas? Accoutrements, handbags, jewelry, watches, a ring on every finger, a large golden cross about her neck, large hoop earrings, a nose ring, a tattoo on her shoulder. Is she more likely to wear Rolex and Gucci, or sandals and a $5 watch off the street? Does she dress more expensively than she can afford, or does she dress down despite her wealth? What colors does she tend to wear? All black? Neon pink? Does she have a good sense of fashion? Are her clothes in line with the latest trend, or 10 years out of style? Grooming. Is she tailored, impeccably dressed, or an unkempt, unbathed slob? Does she shower twice a day, or once a week? Does she smell? Does she wear too much perfume? Body language. Does she stand stiffly, or is she always slumped over? Does she walk in a feminine manner, swinging her hips as she goes? Or does she walk like a man, as if looking for a fight? Voice. Some people can be picked out of a room by their voice alone. Does she have a forceful, booming voice? Can her conversations be heard across the room? Or does she talk in a whisper, hardly audible, so you have always to ask her to repeat herself? Is her voice high or low? Nasal and whiny or clear? Is it the perfectly neutral, business-like voice of a telemarketing professional, or is it the husky, suggestive voice of a prostitute? Does she talk with great speed in a manic rush, or does she beat about the bush, talk so slowly that you watch the clock as you wait for her to finish? Does she stutter, have an accent, a lisp? Now, leaving the bar, apply these rigorous questions to the characters in your work. What details might you add that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character her analysis of herself, would there be any discrepancy? Does she consider herself in line with fashion while wearing outdated clothes? Does she think her voice is sexy while it is loud and piercing? Does she think her jewelry not fancy enough while wearing a Rolex and a gigantic diamond ring? What do any of these discrepancies say about the character? Do they point to any greater issue? The doctor. Imagine you are one of the top doctors in the country, and your speciality is being able to diagnose hard-to-name illnesses. You've just been referred your toughest case yet. He's been to 10 doctors in as many months, and no one can find what's wrong with him. He sits across from you now on his first visit, ready for you to inquire into his medical history. Medical background. How is his general constitution? Can he not get sick in the middle of a jungle? Or does he get sick within 100 feet of someone's germs? Has he ever been seriously sick? With what? How many times? Was it hereditary? If not, how did he contract it? In a foreign country, sleeping with someone? Was he ever hospitalized? What was that like? How much of an impact have his illnesses had on his life? How much do they have right now? Does he have a chronic illness or condition? Is he on any medication, asthma inhaler, blood pressure regulators, antidepressants? How often must he take it, and how does it affect his life? For a diabetic, his illness, his constant monitoring of food, blood sugar, and injections of insulin will be a major part of his life. Are there side effects, interactions? How must he compensate? Not drink, not smoke, adopt a special diet. Has he ever been injured? How? A sports injury? A fight? A car accident? Broken bones? Plastic surgery? Bad back? Tendonitis? Arthritis? Does he have any disabilities? Is he blind? Deaf? Lame? Mute? Mentally challenged? Is he insane? Schizophrenic? Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character his analysis of himself, would there be a discrepancy? Does he consider himself sick, although he is perfectly healthy? Is he a hypochondriac? The psychologist. You're a psychologist, specializing in interfamily dynamics. You've just been referred a new patient and need to know everything about his background before you can begin. Family background. Was he raised by both parents? If not, why? Were they divorced? Was one deceased? How old was he when either of these things happened? If he wasn't raised by both parents, was he raised by his mother or his father? Or did he alternate between them? How much time did he spend with each? Did he live in different homes? Did they live close by? Or was he raised by another relative, grandparent, uncle? Was he raised by a homosexual couple, two fathers, two mothers? Was he adopted? If his parents divorced, did either remarry? Does he have a step-parent? What did his parents do for a living? How did that affect his upbringing? Are his parents still alive now? How old are they? Is he close to them? How often do they talk? How much of an influence have they had on his life? Does he have grandparents? Did they live close by? Did they have a big influence on his life? Are they still alive? How many siblings does he have, if any? Being an only child could be a crucial aspect of a character's makeup, as could his having 6 siblings, brothers or sisters. Has having had 5 brothers made him more masculine? Has having had 5 sisters made him more feminine? Is he the oldest, youngest, or middle child? How does this affect him? Has being the oldest made him more protective, paternal? Has being the youngest made him pampered, spoiled? How old are his siblings? Is he close to them? In competition with them? How often does he see them? Do they live close by? How big of a role do they play in his life? Is he married? At what age? For how long? How did they meet? Did they come together despite the odds? Is he happy? Is she? Are they equal as a couple? Or are there discrepancies between them? in age, wealth, status, education, religion. Are they able to overcome these discrepancies, or are they driving them apart? Do they fight? How often? What are their common interests, if any? Where do they dissent? How do they treat the kids differently? Do they work together? Do they play a pivotal part in each other's lives? Or do they live in separate homes? Do they have a prenuptial agreement? Is either having an affair? With whom? For how long? Does the other know? Does his wife have a large family? How do they get along? How big of a part do they play in his life? Are his siblings married? How does he get along with his brother's wife? His sister's husband? How has marriage changed family dynamics? Do his siblings have children? How does he get along with their kids? Is he a good uncle? Are they all close? Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? The adoption agency. Children. Imagine you work for an adoption agency and a woman has just come through the door who wants to adopt one of your most precious infants. You need to find out everything you possibly can about her current children, if any, fertility, and motives for adopting. What sort of questions might you ask? If childless, does she plan on having children? Is she unable to get pregnant? Has she spent years visiting fertility clinics to no avail? Is she on birth control? Did she have a permanent operation? Does she regret that? Does she worry about her biological clock? If she has children, how many does she have? How many would she like? Or are there more than she wanted to begin with? Did she get pregnant by the first boy she slept with? Were her pregnancies rough? Her deliveries? Did she have any abortions? Lose any babies? Are they all hers by birth? Or are some adopted? Or some from another marriage? Does she resent them for it? How old are her children? What are their names? Were they named after any relatives? How close is she to them? Do they cause her grief? Or do they bring her honor? Is she in competition with them? Are they attending the same colleges she did? How much of herself does she see in them? Does she consider herself a good parent? Do the kids? How does she treat her kids? Is she abusive? Has she ever hit them? Or is she abused by them? Do they listen to her? Does she listen to them? Does she live vicariously through them? What sacrifices has she made for them? Does she have grandchildren? Is she active in their lives? Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character to analyze herself, would there be a discrepancy? Does she consider herself good to the kids while all the while she hits them? Does she consider herself robbed of having many children while she already has six? The employer. Imagine you run a company and are responsible for hiring all new employees. A critical position has just been vacated and a candidate sits before you. The future of your company might lie on his skills and abilities. He is a complete stranger. What might you ask him? Education. Consider not only the basics, whether he completed elementary school, high school, college, or graduate school, but also when he finished these programs. A PhD at 24 is as telling as a BA at 48. How is his grammar, diction, spelling, vocabulary? Is he smart, despite never having been to school? Is he naive, despite his Yale degree? Was he homeschooled? How hard did he have to struggle to get his education? Did his parents pay for it, or did he work himself through college? How much does it mean to him? Does he act or feel superior as a result? Inferior? Any special training? Does he have a commercial driver's license, training as an electrician or in plumbing? Does he take continuing adult education? Is he constantly seeking to educate himself? Does he study new languages or vocabulary words on his own? Is he a big reader? Is he the self-taught type, or does he need the structure of a program? Does he love to learn, or is all education a struggle? Employment. What sort of job does he have right now? A white-collar job? Executive, lawyer, doctor, banker. A middle-end job? Bureaucrat, salesman, manager. A blue-collar job? Mechanic. or a minimum wage job delivering pizza? How long has he had this job? Someone who stays in the same job for 40 years is as telling as someone who switches jobs once a month. Is his job congruous with his background, his level of education, his training? Is he delivering pizzas with a PhD, or is he running a major company with a high school diploma? How hard and how long did he have to work to get where he is now? Did he get help from parents, friends? Does he work for his parents? Is he in his parents' line of profession at all? Is he a direct competitor of his parents? Who are his competitors? Who are his clients? How is he viewed within his company? Is he a slacker? Does he come in late, leave early, and take long lunches and vacations? Is he motivated, organized? Does he have a direct boss? How do they get along? Does he have people below him? How does he treat them? Is he honest in all his business dealings? Does his job consume his life? Is it part-time? Full-time? Is he a workaholic? Work three jobs? Is his role in business his main identity in life? Or is he unemployed? Between jobs? How many jobs has he had? Has he never been able to hold a job? Why not? Problem with authority? Police record? Or is he so rich he doesn't have to work? Is she stuck at home raising kids when she wants to be out working? Does she experience sexual harassment at the office? Has she ever? Is she working in what is traditionally a man's field, i.e. policewoman, firewoman, stockbroker? Is she treated with less respect because she's a woman? Is he working in what is traditionally a woman's field, i.e. hairdresser, schoolteacher? Is he scoffed at because of it? If he is not in a permanent or ideal job right now, what job does he aspire to? Police record. If he were to hire someone, you probably would run a background check, which would include a basic check of their criminal history. Has he ever been arrested? If so, how many times? How frequently? When was his last arrest? Was he convicted? Did he serve time? Where? For how long? Who bailed him out? For how much? Were his crimes violent? Armed robbery, assault, rape, murder, or non-violent? Embezzling money, computer hacking, burglary, auto theft. Why did he turn to crime? Was it a one-time thing? A mistake? An act of desperation? Or did he enjoy it? Is he a career criminal? Has he ever been in a car accident? Was anyone hurt? Does he have many tickets, moving violations? There is a big difference between the man who has a blemish on his record for pool hopping as a teenager and the man who has a blemish for assaulting his ex-girlfriend. Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character to analyze himself, would there be a discrepancy? Does he consider himself a hard worker, although he works 7 hours a day? Does he consider himself well thought of within his company, while the people around him can't stand him? The banker. Imagine your job is to approve mortgages. Your bank has been burned many times before at the cost of hundreds of thousands of dollars, and you've been given the mandate to be extra cautious in approving someone new. An applicant sits before you. What might you like to know? Economics. What's his credit report like? Spotless? Awful? Has he ever declared bankruptcy? Defaulted on a loan? Do creditors call his house night and day? Does he default on other things in life too? Is he spending his life paying off debt? What percentage of his monthly bills does it comprise? How much does he make? Is there any potential for growth? How much does he have in the bank? How much in investments, in collateral? How much in debt? Is he rich, poor, or somewhere in the middle? If rich, how long has he been wealthy? Did he earn it the hard way or receive an inheritance? If poor, has he always been poor? Is there any hope of his being rich? If once rich, how did he lose his money? Is he a gambler? Stock market, horses, casinos? Can he not stop himself from buying goods? Fancy cars, electronics, clothes? Does he have a credit card problem? Is he steeped in college loans, supporting someone else, living off someone else? Did he steal the money? How important is money to him? Does he live in perpetual anxiety over it? Or does he hardly care at all? Was he raised rich? Poor? What was the neighborhood like? Destitute? Ghetto? Working class? Mining or fishing town? Middle class? Suburbia? upper middle class or upper class, Beverly Hills? How did it affect his identity? Does he hate rich people, despise poor people? What are his deep feelings about money and the people who have it? Possessions. Make a list of the major things he owns. What's on there? Any valuables? Jewelry? Artwork? Coins? Stamps? Rare books? Any collections? Expensive furniture? Electronics? Music? Musical instruments? China? Silverware? Plants? Is it a long or short list? What comprises the greatest percentage of it? What does that say about him? How long has he had all of his stuff? Has he owned it all his life? Was it passed down from generations? Or did he just buy it all last week? Did he steal them? Is he renting or leasing them? How much value does he put on his possessions? Does he take good care of his things? Or does he treat them poorly, lose them? How big of a role do they play in his life? Does he equate himself with what he owns? Or does he give everything away? Also see geography, residence, below. Vehicles. Does he own a car, truck, motorcycle? Did he buy, rent, lease, or steal? How old is it? How long has he had it? How frequently does he get new vehicles? How does he treat them? Is he a good driver? Does he spend every weekend waxing his car, or has he not washed it in 10 years? How important is his vehicle in his life? Does he equate it with who he is? Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character to analyze himself, would there be a discrepancy? Does he insist money is unimportant to him while watching every cent? Does he consider himself having been raised humbly while brought up in Beverly Hills? The matchmaker. Imagine you work for the most elite matchmaking service in the country. Your clients are the wealthiest, most eligible bachelors in the world, and they, too busy to look for themselves, are completely trusting you to find them the match of their lives. What might you ask? Romantic history. Has she ever been married? If so, is she separated, divorced, a widow? At what ages did any of these happen? Divorced at 18 can be as telling as single at 60. How many serious relationships has she had? How many passing casual relationships? How big of an impact have these partners have, or do they still have in her life? Is she haunted by past boyfriends, stalked by an ex-husband? Must she still see him once a week when he visits the kids? How frequently does she enter relationships? A new boyfriend once a month or once every 5 years? Is she the one to initiate the breakup? How does she go about meeting men? Does she spend time in bars, place ads in magazines? Does she enjoy life being single? Or is a relationship a necessary part of her life? What does she look for in a mate? Now apply these questions to the characters in your work. What details might you incorporate that you may not have thought of previously? If you were to ask your character to analyze herself, would there be a discrepancy? Does she consider herself hardly ever in a relationship while having 20 boyfriends a year? The real estate agent. Imagine you are a successful real estate agent and a woman has come to you desperate for your help in finding her the perfect place to live. She has no idea where she wants to live and you know nothing about her. What might you ask? Geography, residence. Where does she live now? In a house? Apartment? Trailer? Houseboat? Tent? Does she own or rent? Or is she squatting, crashing at a friend's? Or homeless? How long has she been there? A person who stays in one place for 50 years is as telling as one who moves every week. Is she a homemaker, and is every detail of her residence of the utmost importance? Or is she a slob, and is her residence in need of repair? Is her residence spartan, or crammed with trinkets? Where did she live before? Is it a step up or step down? Who does she live with, if anyone? A roommate, sibling, lover, parent, friend? Are there others in the building, on the block? Are they nuisances? Does she have rowdy neighbors, a peeping Tom? Is she rowdy herself? Does she honor his leases? Does she damage her abodes? What does she aspire to in a living situation? You can tell much about a person by her home. Furniture, books, music, art. Take a look around. What's there? You can tell much by simply looking at titles of books, the types of music, if the furniture is cheap, tacky, or designer. Are there plants? Pictures? Is it warm, lived in? Or is it cold, empty, sterile? You can tell as much about a person who lives in a monastery with only one bag to her name as you can about a woman who lives in a mansion crammed with material goods. Also see possessions above. In general, is she an indoor person? Does she hardly leave her house? Or does she live to be outside, always feel confined, spend all day on her porch, hardly enter her house at all? Geography, location. What country is she in? What state? What town? What street? Where on the street? Does she have a view? What's the neighborhood like? Rich, poor, dangerous, safe. Did she grow up there, near there? Someone who lives in her hometown is as telling as someone who's moved as far away as possible. Is she a traveler? Is she near the ocean, mountains, forest, hills? What's the climate like? Why did she choose this location? Does she aspire for something different? What is keeping her here? Family, job, friends? In general, would you consider her a city dweller? A nature lover? Is she a big traveler? Always on the road? Has she been to every country in the world? Does she set sail for years at a time? Or has she never left her hometown? Pets. Not every place will take pets, so this can be an important factor, as it often is in people's lives. Does she have a dog? What kind? A Rottweiler says as much as a poodle. How many? For how long? Does she take good care of it? How big a role does it have in her life? The owner who sleeps with the dog, cooks it gourmet meals 3 times a day, and takes it to therapy, is as telling as the owner who kicks it when she feels like it. Other pets. Cats. Fish. A snake. Hamsters. Rats. A talking bird. Any of these can silently say something about her. Does she yearn for a pet? Why can't she have it? Because of the building? Because she's allergic? Because her boyfriend is allergic? Does her pet annoy other people in her life? Does she get off on that?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.